excited to be here and talk about this topic, which is very near and dear to my heart. Just as a bit of background on how I got interested in the subject of working with interpreters. So on our service at San Francisco General, we see about 40% of our patients don't communicate in English as a primary language. And so we have gotten to be best friends with our interpreters at San Francisco General and have learned a lot through that process. Feeling like I'm, up on a podium and you guys are sitting in a classroom kind of thing, but I would really love for this to be a session where if there's something, a question comes up along the way, we have a little bit of cushion with time for this session. So if we need to, we can stand up and do a little calisthenics for, people don't get blood clots and things as we go along. But please stop me if anything is confusing or questions come up. So I don't have any significant financial relationships to disclose. I work at a public hospital. I want to give thanks from the beginning to my colleague Heather Harris, who you heard from this morning, and also a colleague from Southern California, Nora Gonzalez, who's an interpreter and social worker. And they helped with the development of a lot of these slides. So the things that I would like to talk about today are how to go through the options that we have in communicating with patients who have limited English proficiency. We'll talk a little bit about that definition. Go through explicitly what are the challenges in working with interpreters and practical strategies for improving working with interpreters. I personally had very, very little idea of the training and the role of the interpreter before I got into this work, and I think that it's actually quite helpful to know where our interpreter colleagues are coming from, so we'll go through that a little bit, and then talk about just the practical challenges of accessing interpreters and some ways to overcome those challenges. So some background first, then we'll get into the meat of the talk. So as you guys have probably seen this before, the Choosing Wisely recommendation from your American Society of Nephrology that we should not be initiating chronic dialysis without ensuring a shared decision-making process between patients, their families, and their physicians. And really, to accomplish that process of shared decision-making, you need to elicit individual patient goals and preferences. And provide information on prognosis and expected benefits and harms of dialysis within their goals and preferences. So the big question is, how do you do that? That's a pretty large undertaking for someone even you can communicate with directly. How do you do that when you can't communicate directly with the patient? And it would be really helpful for me just to frame this talk to find out from you guys what your experiences are. How often does it come up for you in your clinical practice? As I mentioned, for me it comes up every day, but just to get a sense of how often you guys are using interpreters, is it a daily, weekly, monthly, how often does it come up?
Daily.
Mm-hmm. And is it a variety of languages or concentrations of a smaller number of languages that you guys see patients? Variety. What are the main language groups that you guys are seeing?
Mandarin.
Mandarin?
Vietnamese.
Vietnamese, yeah, larger population, especially South Bay. And what are some of the ways, we'll talk a little bit about the pros and cons of different strategies, but I wonder what you guys use or how you communicate with those patients. What are the mechanisms where you are able to communicate with those patients?
We have a phone interpreter.
Phone interpreter?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Great.
And is that hospital-based or in your clinic? Or
yeah.
done in person.
Yeah, some situations. Like
yeah.
Patients that are getting trained on peritoneal dialysis, we've had in person the whole team.
Fantastic.
We have video presentation and a list of employees that are actually trained to be interpreters.
Oh, great.
We call them the meetings over there.
Great. So video conferencing and then employees who are doing other roles but have also been trained as interpreters who can fill in when needed. Anything else? Family members, yeah. Okay, great, that's helpful. So I want to just give a little bit of background in terms of landscape in California in particular. So this is a information from the U.S. Census. It's the American Community Survey from 2011, and it's showing you by county the percentage of the population in that county that reports speaking a language other than English at home. So as you can see, the dark purple colors are more than 47.5%. I'm not sure why they went by 47.5%. Large proportion, almost half of people report speaking another language. The lighter purple color is between about a quarter and a half, and then the rest are between 10% and a quarter, mostly in California. But we have a lot more of the deep purple than other places. And in this survey, about just less than half of the people who report speaking another language other than English at home also report limited English proficiency. And that number is growing. Two-thirds of the people who report speaking another language at home reported speaking Spanish. As I mentioned, this is a dynamic thing. It's changing over time. When this survey was done in the 2000 census, only about 18% of people said that they spoke a language other than English, and it's grown to 21%. It's like, oh, 3%, that's not a lot. But taken across the country, that's millions of people. The number of people across the nation who report limited English proficiency went from about 8% to 9% by the 2010 census. So when you look in California, we have about double the numbers, the national numbers, in terms of people who speak another language other than English at home, and those who report limited English proficiency. And you'll hear me say that again and again, limited English proficiency, and what that is on the census, people are asked to rate how comfortable they speak, how well they speak English. And the criteria for limited English proficiency in terms of healthcare is people who say that they speak English less than very well, because unless you're speaking very well, the complexity of medical decision-making and education and things, the feeling is that we should be trying to communicate with those folks in their preferred language. So I want to just talk background about what are the different options that we have. So we've thrown out some of the different options. So some providers have some degree of proficiency in a second language and might try to leverage those skills when they're seeing a patient who doesn't communicate in English. Another strategy is to use what's called an ad hoc interpreter, and we'll go through that. Or, of course, you can use a professional interpreter. So there's this idea of getting by with second language skills. And that's the idea of, well, I speak a little bit of Spanish. And that's kind of my sense. I kind of jokingly say, I can do pre-rounding Spanish. So I can do, you know, do you have pain? Do you have pain in your chest? Do you have pain in your head? Those sort of things. In training, in particular, residents report leveraging these limited second language skills quite often because it feels a lot more efficient. But there's significant concern about when we do that. And interestingly, there was a study talking with residents about this very issue. And one of the reasons that they said beyond efficiency was the desire to practice their second language skills, that they wanted to use, you know, Spanish proficiency or things like that and grow in it, which is not a bad thing. unless it compromises patient care. So when they looked at this in the emergency department among Spanish-speaking patients, 87% of people who didn't get an interpreter actually thought that one really should have been used when they were asked. They would have preferred an interpreter. And way fewer people who didn't get an interpreter reported good to excellent understanding of their disease compared to people who had an interpreter. Now, we know we do woefully bad in terms of education across the board for anyone, including, you know, people who speak English, but even harder when we're assuming that they can understand complicated instructions and diagnostic information in a second language. So the second option is when I mentioned ad hoc interpreters. So ad hoc interpreters are any untrained person who's called upon to interpret. So that could be a family member, that could be a staff member who's not trained as an interpreter, or even a bystander. And it always kind of seems shocking when people say bystander. Like, you know, I'll just grab this random person who's standing next to this patient for a confidential encounter. But actually, you know, we probably do it all the time if there are two people sitting in a waiting room and you're actually trying to find a patient and say, like, oh, could you speak some English? Can you tell him that we need to go back? You know, like that kind of little limited stuff, I think, actually happens not infrequently. Why do we do that? Well, it's convenient. You know, to have someone who's either there in your practice or to use a family member. And there are some good things about using family members in certain situations. The study that that I mentioned here in the Journal of General Internal Medicine, some family members feel like they're more comfortable discussing things, sensitive topics, among themselves as a family. I'd say that the thing that is tricky about this is unless you have proficiency in that language, you really have no idea what is being communicated to the patient, even though there's greater comfort. I would say that generally my practice, when there's a family member who says, you know, I would like to be the interpreter, I generally say, well, it's, you know, fantastic that you want to help out. I encourage you to actively participate in the conversation. I speak lousy Tagalog. So I'm going to request an interpreter just for myself so that I can hear directly what your dad is saying or what your mom is saying so that I have that opportunity. Because I feel like I gain a lot by actually hearing directly what the patient is saying. Yeah?
I just wanted to say that I work for a police organization. I work with an elderly population. Mm-hmm. Many of them are you know, they've got renal failure I'm in behavioral health, and for the Hispanic population, it's a mix. It can be a real tricky deal to use family as the interpreter taking a mental health history.
Absolutely, absolutely.
It's a tricky deal, because some families, everybody knows what everybody knows, and in other families, you know, there's still the stigma.
And recognizing that it's really hard. I mean, you know, where I work, I'm really fortunate in that the major language groups I can have in-person interpreters, but for a number of the smaller language groups, I have to go through the phone, and that sometimes feels like its own barrier when you're talking about sensitive topics. The point of this talk is not to say that there are options that feel perfect or, you know, or easy. Each of them have their pros and cons. The one other thing that I'll say about using ad hoc interpreters, particularly staff. In our hospital, for example, we don't have any in-person Tagalog interpreters. We have quite a few nursing staff who speak Tagalog and are available as interpreters. But I would say that the tricky thing is figuring out who then covers their patients when they're being used as an interpreter. So there's kind of a hidden cost that's incurred when you use staff who are assigned to do something else as your interpreters. And then, so there's a really nice review of the literature looking at the use of these ad hoc interpreters versus professional interpreters. And their findings from all of the studies that had been done is that both clinicians and patients were both more satisfied with professional interpreters, and that the professional interpreters improved care more than the ad hoc interpreters. And unfortunately, when there were communication errors in another study, the errors that were made by ad hoc interpreters were felt to be more likely to have clinical consequence. Yeah. And so that's why I kind of bring in the language of this is for me. It's not for, you know, like, I know that you are fantastic. You speak perfect English and you're more than happy to do that. And I really appreciate that. But for me, it's important to be able to hear directly what Mr. Smith is saying. And I think that my experience is that the tendency when the family member is interpreting is that you get far, far less from the patient directly, that they're kind of saying, oh yeah, he has shortness of breath, oh yeah, he has pain, oh yeah, this is what's been happening. And even when I, you know, so I'm really accustomed to how do I work with a professional interpreter where I ask a question that's directly interpreted and then the patient, you know, and I hear kind of directly back. Even if I try to do that, because the family member is not a trained interpreter, they usually don't do that. They'll just kind of answer and editorialize. So I say, one of my colleagues suggested this, and I really like it, which is like, you know, I know you speak perfect English, but my Cantonese stinks. So I really need an interpreter for myself. And, you know, and please feel free, your opinion and your insight is very valuable, and we want you to be part of this conversation as well. But it's just for my own comfort. Yeah.
I'm just wondering. I don't know how you can control for this, but as long as there's a family member there, if there's a family member there, it's going to change. It might change the patient's answers,
mm-hmm.
right? Because they understand the language, so. They might be reluctant to answer the question honestly anyway,
mm-hmm.
or completely,
mm-hmm.
because they're afraid of how it's going to affect the person in the room. So
mm-hmm.
what do you do in that situation? I mean, how do you control for that? I don't know if you can.
Yeah. So some of the ways, you know, that people get around things where they have sensitive topics, you know, like when asked about domestic violence or drug use or, you know, certain things like that. So one way that providers get around that without kind of creating an additional rift or anger with a very, you know, supportive, well-meaning family member is to say, when I'm doing my exam part of the interview, I'm going to ask you to step out for just a minute and then ask the patient directly and say, you know, how do you feel about having the visit directly with your daughter? Is there anything that, you know, you feel uncomfortable talking about in front of your daughter? Is there anything that you want to tell me that you didn't want to say in front of her? So then you open the door and they say, no, I'm totally comfortable having her here. Then you have kind of carte blanche for follow-up. Yeah, absolutely. Great questions. So professional interpreters, why, what kind of evidence is there for professional interpreters? So when you look at, again, the similar review article, professional interpreters, they improve care for patients with limited English proficiency, less communication error, better patient comprehension, better clinical outcomes, better satisfaction, and then the disparities in care that we know exist seem to be somewhat mitigated by having professional interpreters, and we'll talk about why that might be with interpreters and the role, different roles that they play. So there's kind of, that's the carrot side of things, that professional interpreters really help, have been shown to improve care. And then this is kind of the stick side of it, that providing access to interpreter services is actually required by law. So there's state and federal legislation going back to the Civil Rights Act that guards against discrimination on the basis of national origin, and language is under that umbrella. It's been included under that umbrella. And then in the late 90s, there was legislation that said, okay, if you take money for Medicaid or Medicare patients, then you have to provide adequate language assistance to patients who have limited English proficiency. And then in California, we got more specific about it, saying that all health plans and insurers have to provide an interpreter for limited English proficient patients at no cost to the patients. And this is actually a really interesting point that some of my colleagues did a small study with patients with limited English proficiency who were hospitalized at UCSF, where a lot of the patients didn't ask for interpreters because they thought that it was an extra charge. So that's one of the things that I actually tell my patients when using an interpreter, is that this is a free service to you. Yeah?
Are you saying that I, as a healthcare professional, can bill the insurance for the cost of the professional?
Touché. No, this is more like the legislation saying that all hospitals have to be up to a higher seismic code. It's an unfunded mandate.
But it says health plans and insurers.
So they have to provide access, but it doesn't mean that it's like a billable service. Yeah, unfortunately. So I just wanted to take, kind of before we go into the challenges of working with professional interpreters, since there's a variety of different mechanisms that people in the room use to communicate with limited English proficient patients, I wanted to get a sense from you guys around what are the pros and the cons of the ways that you, the main ways that you use to communicate with these patients? The things you like about it, don't like about it. Yeah.
I really don't like phones. I think, I see that it does have some benefit for the patient, but I feel, and I try to remain like eye contact with the patient instead of a phone. But I don't know, it still just feels very genuine, and especially when assessing the health, it just doesn't feel like you're really able to get anywhere. Because I'm myself trying to create rapport and trust with this patient, and it's like, it just kind of feels like there's not a lot for it. And especially, like, maybe if it was the same interpreter every time or something, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's also really hard because I'm in the dialysis unit, and there's a lot of other noise,
yeah.
And there's no privacy, and,
yeah, those are hard things. And one thing that's really interesting, and even that I don't know of any studies that look at kind of comparison of different over-the-phone mechanisms. So for in my hospital, we have a speakerphone that's on a rolling cart, essentially, that we roll into the room, and it's got, you know, remote kind of Wi-Fi access, so you can rotate it all over the unit. And I find that really hard, both in all the ambient noise, like you're talking about, and also a lot of times if the patient is frail and they can't communicate loudly, then the interpreter can't hear them, those sorts of things. But I've seen other ones where you have a dual headset phone where you're actually more directly looking eye to eye, and you can, you know, communicate directly into our seen headsets that do that. And so it's interesting because it's over the phone still, but just because it's a different mechanism, it does feel a little bit different. Yeah. Other,
just the added time that it often takes.
Uh-huh.
The sort of, you lose control over kind of sometimes guiding the conversation the way you can in your native language. So sometimes, you ask a question and the patient gives an answer and then kind of completely will go off on some other tangent.
Yeah.
It's very easy to actually lose the track of your conversation.
Yep. Where you come back and you're kind of like, the response is nothing close to what you asked about. Yeah.
To add on to that, actually, that's what I was thinking, is I've had times when, because I'm an outpatient, I think sometimes patients feel, oh, I have someone that speaks my language, so I'm going to ask anything and everything about healthcare to this one person. And then, again, you lose track of, oh my God, I called you for palliative care, and now we're talking about, like, everything else.
Walgreens prescriptions.
Yeah, and it's frustrating. And then the other thing is, it's the time, because again, an outpatient, we try to arrange them in person, and then a lot of times, you know, the patients might no-show or run late, or we have to reschedule at the drop of a dime. And then again, I mean, of course, we're not paying out of pocket, but for the healthcare system, right, it's a lot of added cost, because now there's a person physically there waiting.
Which is one of the reasons why a lot of people have gone to remote interpreter services. It's that's definitely a concern. It's interesting when they studied it, interpreted conversations like family meetings versus just in English. What they've actually found is that the time is, if anything, shorter when you use interpreters, which is the opposite. It should be double. So one wonders what's being left out for patients who have limited English proficiency, because it does, you know, we're not given double the time in a clinic visit with a patient who's limited English proficiency. You have the same amount of time, so.
Probably you could
cut
short the corners and just
yeah.
And I would actually comment that that's been one of the pros that I've seen in doing palliative care with the telephone interpreter services, is that it forces the team to have to strategize in advance, because we've had a lot of, like, a couple of instances where it's like, oh my gosh, that was way too long, and then everyone's like, okay, what are we going to say, how are we going to revert, and everyone will kind of strategize to have the role to kind of make it efficient, so.
I think just having an interpreter on a telephone case manager. So it actually, if it's my first time talking to a patient and they know I have an interpreter on the line, sometimes they're the conversation kind of goes better, they trust you more, you're able to kind of have a better connection with them, you know, during your call.
Yeah, it means a lot. I had a colleague at my hospital who heard from a patient who was getting sicker in the middle of the night. They requested her in particular, and the reason that the patient requested her is because she always calls for an interpreter.
I'm a therapist that works in the home. And I found the telephone is fantastic. It's like having a senior advisor there. I can explain what I'm seeing, and they're just amazing at being able to tell the patient, and the patient trusts them and asks questions, and the family does.
I mean, it's interesting because you guys brought up the issue of in-person interpreters waiting and things, and I don't know that you have this experience, but sometimes with in-person interpreters, they have another appointment to get to, or they get paged in the middle of your conversation, whereas the over-the-phone interpreters, I feel like it's actually kind of the opposite. You know, if I say, oh, interpreter, can you hang on, you know, she's going to the bathroom, or she's getting a pill right now, or they're crying, just stick with us, they're more than happy usually to just hang out on the line and wait for you, where there isn't time pressure.
I think another inherent con is the loss in translation. I mean, we're talking about palliative care that, you know, I would say based on personal experience and what I've read, is it's a very much a Western thought and school and a newer practice, and now you have this young field and now trying to establish it across cultures, you know, and we've discussed it in our team where the interpreter is saying, you know, blah, 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 palliative care. And we're like, well, why are you, you know? And so how do you get that across? Or we're having a goals of care discussion to fill out the polls. And then they're saying, do not resuscitate in the middle of this long sentence. And I'm like.
Right. Which I think sometimes can be okay, because then it forces you to explain what the concept is in the way that you prefer to explain, as opposed to the interpreter editorializing about what palliative care is, which can be, in my experience, really tough. I err on the side of assuming that people don't know what palliative care is, and I explain it. And even sometimes when I've been in encounters with interpreters where I say, I'm Dr. Kinderman, I'm from the palliative care team, I'll explain what that is. They'll use what they think is the word palliative care. And I had just like a couple weeks ago an experience where the family kind of under on the side was like, you know, like, don't say that, because it was a word that they associated with hospice and they didn't want the patient to hear that word. So it's a double-edged sword kind of thing. Yeah. So maybe one more and then we'll move along.
Thanks. I had a situation with a patient who, after the appointment, broke down to us with another interpreter to let us know how awful the previous one had been. She was rude to him. She was telling him to, like, hush, hush, because he kept asking questions. And that's not something that we know.
Yeah.
If we don't speak the language.
Yeah.
So it's a trust thing, too.
It's definitely. And I'll talk a little bit more about that when we get into expectations that you all should have of professional interpreters and you know, the standards that we should be holding them to as well, and how I usually handle that. So I wanted to kind of dig into these challenges, many of which have already popped up. Losing control over the message that's conveyed, having to integrate an outsider into your team, particularly if you work as a team, and then the access issue. So lost in translation, you totally played into my hand. So this is from that great 2003 movie with Bill Murray, and one of my favorite scenes is when he is in a photo shoot and there's like direction back and forth and back and forth and back and forth in Japanese, and then it's like a two-word direction that he gets, and he's kind of like, really, that was it? And I definitely have that feeling sometimes when you're listening to interpreters talking to patients and you're not hearing what's going on. So, you know, we, especially for me as a palliative care doc, or if you're in nephrology and you get used to the way that you explain something and the way that you make similes or metaphors or, you know, euphemisms and things like that that just come naturally to you. And I actually don't think scripts are a bad thing. I think that especially in difficult conversations, it's good to have some standard ways that you say things. But the question is how that comes across in another language. I personally think it's harder to gauge patient understanding, and taking care of patients who have limited English proficiency. We usually worry about, is my message getting across through the interpreter? But it's also the other way, right? Like, you're not so sure that you're hearing exactly what the patient is saying either. There's data behind this. So a study is a small study, but it looked at ICU family meetings with professional interpreters, and over half of them had alterations in meaning. And so those were things where the interpreter added or left something out, changed it up, or made editorial comments. And over three quarters of the alterations were considered clinically significant, and almost all of those were in a bad way. So this is kind of professional interpreter are the best we've got, and there still are significant issues there that we need to be aware of. One of the other big challenges that I see is what I call the invisible team member. So we get really used to the dynamics, especially if you work in a small clinic or a small hospital, the staff that you work with and how you work together. And then you bring someone new into the mix, and that changes up the dynamic. You often don't know that person well, the interpreter, and what to expect from him or her personally. And the other thing is that, you know, when I'm having a really difficult family meeting coming up in the afternoon, I know usually in the morning that I have a difficult family meeting coming up, and I can mentally and emotionally prepare for it all day. Interpreters may have just been talking with someone about breastfeeding or, you know, their next follow-up appointment, something very bland, and now they're thrust into a situation where you're talking about life and death and really emotionally charged situations, and they had no warning on it. And then the limited access issue for interpreters is really key. So we just don't have enough So, you know, in 2009, estimates were that there were 15,000 to 17,000 people in the U.S. who were doing medical interpreting. And by contrast, the census in 2000 said that there were over 10 million people who said that they had limited English proficiency. So that's like one interpreter for every 600 Americans. And if you compare that with a place like Sweden, where they have 3,000 interpreters for 8.5 million people total in the country, they have, they're a lot more resource when it comes to interpreters. It's really challenging because in-person interpreters often have limited hours. So for that late family meeting, you may not be able to get an in-person interpreter, or they might be pulled away to other things. You might not have support, particularly in person, for all languages. And then if you use remote interpreter services or professional interpreters, it's costly. So if you guys use the commercial services like LanguageLine or Pacific Interpreters or those, they can be, you know, what's quoted is $1.50 a minute, but it's really based on volume. So if you're a small volume like hospice or clinic, it can be more like $5 an hour. So it's no joke, it's expensive. And then there are networks of interpreters that I'll talk about later that are fantastic, but also have really significant startup costs and then costs per minute when you're accessing them. So these are real issues. But there are things that we can do about them. That was kind of the bad news part of things, and then I want to spend really the rest of the talk talking about ways to address these challenges and to make things better. So the first thing that I want to talk about,
Before you go on, the one thing you didn't talk about, and we look at language. We look at it as a language, and I was confronted with a patient and his mother, who spoke no English, spoke Cantonese. But then, and we had lots of people who could translate. The physician staff was good, and I had a colleague who did it via live phone with us when I needed it. He spoke English, but he translated to his mother, and I didn't trust that at all, because he was 19. But what happened was that we assumed she spoke Cantonese. That was fine. Then we found out that she had a dialect that absolutely no one could understand. And all at once, everybody who was speaking Cantonese said, we have no idea what she's saying, because she came from another area, and there was a local dialect that we could not, there's no way we could find a professional interpreter for. And that was very frustrating.
Have any of you heard of or read the book, The Spirit Catches You and You Fall Down? It's really compelling. I highly recommend it if you haven't read it. That goes a lot into these communication barriers and language access issues and things. And it's a real problem for small communities in particular. These services are difficult and costly. So the first thing that I want to talk about is how setting expectations for these conversations. So I think it's helpful to know where our interpreters are coming from in terms of their training and certification, things to expect in terms of professionalism and their role, and then to know what the interpreter expects of you as the provider who's trying to communicate through the interpreter. So there was a study done by the California Endowment about 10 years ago that looked at what are the training programs like for professional interpreters. And there are more and more of them, fortunately, and especially in California. A lot of them are based in community colleges or actually in healthcare organizations that serve non-English speaking populations. The average length of training for these programs is 40 hours. So, you know, I think about this number a lot when I'm listening to the radio, and you guys know those like sleep train or, you know, the kind of your sleep number, and they say we got 200 hours worth of training for your bed, like picking the firmness of your bed. They get 200 hours of training, and if you have a professional interpreter who's talking about end of life stuff, they may have just had 40 hours, and that's the average. So I find that obviously a little bit disturbing. the scope of their training in a lot of these programs is around the role and ethics of interpreting, the basic interpreting techniques, controlling the flow of the session, which I think is actually one of the big advantages of people who have training as interpreters, because we all are not used to stopping after a few sentences or things to allow for interpretation to happen. And so the interpreter has to be able to say, stop, I need to interpret that, and then you can keep going. So some interpreters you'll see just let that happen, it's going and going and going and going, but that's what part of their role is, to control the flow of the session. They learn some medical terminology. So it's actually interesting, even if you're just interpreting in two languages, it's almost like four languages, right? So there's like common language in English and the other language, and then there's medical terminology in both languages. They get professional development training, and then the impact of culture on interpreting. Certification for interpreters is something that's fairly new, and there's kind of two different certification bodies that are vying for. We are the certification body, and neither one of them is really kind of pulling ahead at this point. But most of them, to get certified, you have to have a U.S. high school diploma, which is kind of a proxy for English proficiency. And they have to have completed at least 40 hours of training, and then they are tested on English proficiency and proficiency in the target language. And most of them have written and oral testing. So I think that'll be a good thing for the field. So I think the bottom line in what to expect from interpreters is wide variability, both in the background of the interpreters and their experience. We have some interpreters who've been there at our hospital for a few months, and others that have been there for 30 years. We have an interpreter who was a surgeon in China. So if you can imagine, I try to, like when I get impatient with this gentleman, I try to imagine what it would be like if I took one of my surgical colleagues with me to another country and asked him or her to interpret for me, and how that might go. So it's an interesting dynamic. There's wide variability in their English proficiency, and I've really learned this as I've gotten to be have more just casual relationships with our interpreters. There's a wide variability there. Professionalism in terms of their role as an interpreter, people have variability in that, and their acculturation to the U.S. and their understanding of things. So you absolutely should expect of the interpreter that they manage the flow of the session and that they convey everything that's said as accurately as possible. So if I'm in the situation where I hear back and forth and back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, and I'm not getting anything back from the interpreter, I have a fairly low threshold to say, interpreter, it seems like there's a lot going on that I'm not hearing about. Can you tell me what you're talking with her about? And more often than not, it's that the interpreter asked a question and then the response was discordant from what the question was. And so the interpreter will then take the initiative to try to clarify. And the really high quality interpreters that you get should say to you, doctor or provider, whoever, I don't think she understood the question, I'm gonna try to rephrase, or you know, that kind of thing. That'll be more transparent with you. But you absolutely, I encourage you to interrupt if what you hear is patient going on and on and on and on, and the interpreter isn't stopping them, to say, interpreter, I'm worried that we might miss some things. Can you stop her? You know, so those are things that we don't know to expect or demand of our interpreters. And absolutely, if there's an encounter where you find out, it's hard after the fact, but if you use commercial services, what they'll usually tell you is, I'm interpreter number 4567, I actually, at this point, if I have a really positive experience or a really negative experience, I'll ask again for the number of the interpreter, and I'll tell our director of interpreter services, please pass along, this person was fantastic, or we should never use this person again. So if I found out about that experience, and it's hard after the fact, but
yeah, we did that.
So So I wanted to go through the different roles that interpreters can play, and I think that we, this is not something that you might kind of think explicitly, you might have a general sense of this, but to make it explicit I think is helpful. So there are all these different roles that interpreters can actually play. So the ones that we typically think of are, and what they use most often is as the message converter. So the goal of taking a message from one language and conveying the meaning and the tone of it as accurately as possible into another language, and controlling the flow and interpreting everything that's said. Kind of the basic ethics, and this is really where interpreters spend most of their time in this role. The next kind of level up in complexity is thinking about the interpreter as a message clarifier. So this is something where if the interpreter, again, gets a sense that the patient didn't understand the question, or if the provider isn't getting what the patient is saying, to say, you know, doctor, I think that she's confused, or I think she didn't understand the question, can you rephrase? And so these are things that the interpreter might notice, and it might be things like the interpreters will say, they call it the register, so they'll get a sense of the patient's maybe their education level or their health literacy just from the words that they're using, and so they can clue you in to, I think that this is the level that you're talking is over her head, so we may want to make this a little simpler, this concept. And if the provider is using things that don't translate, like euphemisms or metaphors or things like that, you know, like, and it's natural. We see them all the time where it's like, you know, well, the shoe's on the other foot, you know, or things like that that just may have sound crazy in another language. The interpreter should kind of go, pause, that might not translate, or, you know, can we say this a different way? The next level up is the cultural clarifier role. So this is when an interpreter might recognize cultural barriers that get in the way of healthcare decisions or access to care, and really bridging the divide between the patient and the provider. So he or she might pick up on body language things that might not be familiar to you. If you're kind of from this country, facial expressions, different speech patterns, and specific implications around decision-making and end-of-life issues, in my case, they might be able to clue you in on. And then the final level is this patient advocate level. And the idea is that the interpreter rarely uses this, but if the interpreter is seeing something that feels like is contributing to disparities in access, where the patient is not getting the services that he or she knows are available, or are getting lower quality service than English-speaking patients or other patients from this group, the interpreter can advocate for the patient in that way. And it's not necessarily an intentional disparity. Say, you know, the provider just doesn't know that there's a Spanish-speaking bereavement group or something like that. The interpreter can say, hey, you know, pause, provider, I don't know whether you know this, but I've heard of this group, and you might want to suggest it to the patient. So the idea is that the interpreter kind of goes up and down these levels as needed, and these are all the different roles that he or she can take in the course of even a single encounter. So what are the expectations of providers that interpreters have? So already brought up some of them. So we should be communicating in first person. So don't say, you know, does she have pain? Do you have pain? It's as if you are talking to that person directly. Maintaining eye contact with the patient. It sometimes feels unnatural. I'm just gonna put it out there. You're speaking to someone who can't understand you. A lot of times I'll try to look at the patient and the patient will look at the interpreter, and that's kind of how it goes. But I would say that the looking at the patient in that gap in interpreting is a really nice time for kind of building rapport with a lot of nonverbal cues. So I'll do nodding and kind of assurance in between times. Trying to minimize your jargon, euphemisms and metaphors and proverbs that don't necessarily translate well. Doing questions and information in short chunks. So, you know, one kind of thought pausing, checking for understanding, and then moving on to the next thing. And then, as I said, if you want to speak to the interpreter, start your sentence with interpreter. So that way, he or she doesn't get confused about who you're talking to. So we will, I have a really, something that hits home on memory issues and using short phrases. We will get to it, time permitting, but I want to make sure that we get through the content, and hopefully we'll be able to do that. So we've talked about expectations. The next thing that I want to talk about is framing the encounter. I encourage you to include the interpreter in preparing for and evaluating encounters with patients and families. So unless the interpreter is part of your staff, that person, like I said, usually doesn't know what he or she is walking into if it's an important conversation. So this is kind of what I see is when we talk about delivering bad news, the formula is to what we call fire a warning shot, where you say, I have some bad news, pause, and then you give your bad news. And so the pre-meeting with the interpreter is kind of like my firing a warning shot to say, interpreter, this is what I'm hoping to go through today, and that at least gives them a few seconds or minutes to emotionally prepare for what they're walking into. I know a lot of times when you're in talks and you're kind of like, oh, this is the gold standard and it's not real life kind of stuff. This seriously takes me, 1 or 2 minutes, and I think is actually really helps with efficiency, going through what I'm going to talk with a patient about, the terms that you might use. If the interpreter is not familiar with that, for me, palliative care is a really important term to get clear on how the interpreter is going to say that. Anticipating any problems that might come up, particularly if I know anything that came up last time with the patient or the family, or just what I'm thinking going into the meeting. And then getting input from the interpreter. So asking the interpreter whether he or she knows the patient. So particularly with language groups that are smaller, these communities can be really intimate. And so confidentiality can actually be a problem. So asking the interpreter whether they know this patient, and then asking the next question of, do you know this patient personally or professionally? Yeah, question.
Can I ask in a real life scenario, using the phone interpreter?
Yes.
Do you do this with a phone interpreter before going into the room?
Yeah.
What about if the phone is in the clinic and you're dialing in as the patient and the family are there already?
Yeah. So what I would do in that situation is to dial up and then say, interpreter, before we start, I want to prep you on what we're talking about. Can you tell the patient or family that I'm going to just give you a little bit of background before we begin the encounter? Is that okay? Can you tell them that? And hopefully the, some of these things around, do they know the person? It's even better, I would say, to get that out, like in the open, even if, some of the family members have English proficiency and can understand what you're saying. I think that kind of brings out into the open, like, this is an issue that I'm paying attention to. Confidentiality is important to me, and I value that. Or continuity. So I've had interpreters that I've worked with where I've never seen this patient before, but the interpreter has seen them over months or even years and can actually give me background on the dynamics. So asking the interpreter what's if they know the patient, what's worked well in the past, what's not worked well, and are there cultural issues or concerns that we should be aware of. Then after the meeting, doing a little bit of debriefing, and again, this can be really short, a minute, 2 minutes, and asking things like, did it feel like there was anything that I missed, that I lost? And so my kind of preeminent example of this is I came out of a family meeting with a Spanish-speaking woman who a lot of her kids spoke English very proficiently, and they spoke directly with us, and then an interpreter sitting next to the patient keeping her in the loop so she could be part of the meeting. And the kids were talking about how they felt really overwhelmed by the idea of taking care of her at home. She was going to potentially go home with hospice. And the patient turned to the interpreter as this dialogue was going on between myself and the family. And the patient turned to the interpreter and said, "You see, at the end, you're all alone." And that was actually really huge. Like, emotionally, that was a really huge thing for that patient. And if I didn't have a good relationship with that interpreter or I didn't ask, I would have completely missed that. And this happens a lot with side conversations that are happening. Some interpreters are really good at kind of saying, "Family, my role as the interpreter is to interpret everything that's said here. And so if you don't want something interpreted, don't say it." A lot of times it's hard to kind of keep control over everything that's going. Again, there's a lot of variability between interpreters, but asking about side conversations, if they were happening, they weren't interpreted. What went well, what went badly, what could we do better next time? And then how is the interpreter doing? These are really stressful things, and I chose to go into palliative care. I dig these conversations. They're difficult, but they're really important, and I picked it. A lot of my colleagues say to me, "I would never do palliative care in a million years," and that's the way that some interpreters feel, too. So getting a sense of how they're doing and encouraging them to take a breath, take a break after is important. So before we move on, any questions? Great. Training interpreters. So I think it's important to really specifically address any deficiencies that are in your interpreter staff. So if you're using contract interpreter services, I think if there's one that you use in particular, finding out a little bit more, particularly if there have been issues around, like, are your interpreters certified? What kind of continuing education do they get? Do they get any specific training in my field, in nephrology or anything? And if you have on-site interpreters, asking them, offering training in nephrology, talking a little bit about what is the background, some basics and things, words that you're going to use over and over again, and making sure that they're really solid in that, I think is a great idea. Some professional interpreter associations have additional training that they offer, continuing education. And then for individual interpreters that you work with a lot, identifying their strengths and their weaknesses, then leveraging those or being aware of them. So for myself, there's a slide that I missed out putting in here that I will say, if you're talking about end-of-life issues in particular with patients, myself and two other colleagues with the support of the California Healthcare Foundation, we developed a curriculum in interpreting and palliative care, actually, that goes through vocabulary for palliative care and hospice. It goes through control of the session and trying to empower interpreters to stop the flow of the session if they think that messages are being lost or misunderstood. And so it's either an 8-hour in-person curriculum that you can download all the materials for free, or individual interpreters can go online and do the curriculum themselves. So in a completely unbiased way, I think that it's a really great resource. So when we update the slides, that information will be on there. Yeah. So I will do the updated version of this. I'll send that and we'll post it on the website for you guys. Yeah. So lastly, enhancing access to interpreter services. So bilingual staff, I think there are a lot of good things about having bilingual staff in terms of trust. So you brought up, kind of the idea of we are having a discussion about this, but all of a sudden we're having a discussion about every healthcare issue that we've been wanting to talk about, but no one has really been able to hear because there hasn't been an opportunity or there hasn't been that trust, frankly. So it's not an insignificant thing, and it's been demonstrated in several studies and improved outcomes. The cost issue, it really depends, again, on whether this is a role and it's a provider who's just going to see a disproportionate number of patients in this other language and be doing their regular role, but just with more patients in that other language, or whether it's someone who you're going to be pulling away from their duties to do something else. And it is certainly efficient to use bilingual staff. Some of the cons, you can't always find a Russian-speaking palliative care doctor when you want one, So you don't have unlimited resources. If there isn't formal training in interpreting, then you don't have some of those issues around using first person and stopping and controlling the flow of the session and interpreting everything and all of those things that I've come to rely on with professional interpreters. And then again, limited vocabulary in either one language or another. So how can we get better access? Advocating for professional interpreter services. Again, we have to do it. It's not a, this would be nice to do, but it's actually required by law. Grant funding is one opportunity to, so we, for instance, used some grant funding to get more of the interpreter phones in our hospital to expand access. And then using emerging technologies, which I'll talk about a little bit more in the next slide. So there are these organizations where you share interpreter services. So there's an organization called the Healthcare Interpreter Network, where basically you have your bank of interpreters that you've hired and you're paying, and calls go first to that bank of interpreters. You're not going to pay extra because you're already paying for them. But if all of those people are occupied, then the call goes out to the network, and you get kind of ready access to an interpreter at one of the other sites. So it's a way that you can kind of expand your pool of interpreters, at least for remote interpretation. And some of these services, like LanguageLine, will have in-person interpreters that are available that you can kind of ask for in advance. My understanding is that you have to pay extra for that service, but that's something that you can get. And there are a bunch of new things that are coming out in terms of different modalities. People mentioned video conferencing, telephone, and then portable devices. So I think this is one of the new kind of waves of the future, is doing this type of stuff over the phone. And you know, they're translating apps and things. I would say I'd be really careful about relying on like Google Translate or things for healthcare encounters, just for a lot of medical legal reasons. So remote interpretations, when this has been studied, time and efficiency, there are shorter intervals between encounters for the interpreter, so they can do a lot more. And we talked a little bit about the effect of the length of the encounters themselves. There's kind of some studies that say it takes longer, some that it takes less. It's a little bit of a mixed bag. And in terms of satisfaction, both providers and patients prefer in-person, which makes sense. And there's a general preference for video over telephone and remote encounters. But interestingly, as we've talked about, the accuracy in some cases may even be better than remote interpretation. And I think that part of that is a time pressure issue and things. So just in general, the benefits and challenges of using remote interpreters, it's really nice to have access all the time, to have access to so many different languages at once, being able to access it all over, kind of on demand, having trained interpreters, and potentially saves time and cost. But it can be really costly, particularly in startup and equipment when it breaks down, or you know, it's just clunky, or it's trouble connecting. And there's a feeling that it's less personal, as we've talked about, and particularly in important conversations. So I think that some people, you know, kind of learn ways to get around that, whether it's the device itself or pre-meeting with the interpreter and creating that connection. But there are certainly challenges to it. So my take-home points, we want to have time for questions and things and potentially do this memory exercise with you guys. But in general, what I want you guys to walk away with is that really there's good support for using professional interpreters to improve patient understanding and satisfaction. It's really important to know where your interpreters are coming from and what to expect from them, and to leverage those roles that they play beyond just simply converting the message from one language to another, but to really learn from your interpreters. Optimizing individual encounters by using best practices in interpreters, those things like using first person and making eye contact and things, and framing the conversation with the interpreter both before and after the encounter. Getting to know and training your interpreters, I think, is the single most important thing I've done in improving conversations with patients in my hospital. Considering the different remote interpreter services in situations where you want to enhance access. So with that, I'll give some space for questions and say thank you for letting me talk to you guys today.
So what has happened to me occasionally, so I speak, Spanish, I would say better than pre-Rani level, like I can do, your basic H&P and your basic follow-up because I'm comfortable and I probably understand it better than I speak it. But I always will call a professional trigger in if I'm having any sort of a whole secure discussion.
Mm-hmm.
And every now and then, I will say something, I have to, they're there, their job is there to repeat what I say, but I can tell that what they're saying is not exactly what I said. And so just sort of some advice and kind of how to call them out on that without obviously, pissing them off or alienating them. But, every now and then I'll be like, no, that's not what I said. And then they're sort of like, well, why am I here then, right? And so,
yeah. Yeah, so one way that you can say this is, at the beginning is to say, interpreter, just to let you know, I communicate in Spanish and I'm fairly proficient, but I'm going to be talking about some sensitive things, so I want to be really clear that that everything is interpreted, as accurately as possible. And so so that kind of, it's a warning shot for them so they know who they're talking to, but to say, this is a serious conversation and this is what I'm looking for from you. So to say, and if you kind of have a second to say, I choose my words really carefully. And if there's something that you don't understand or you feel uncomfortable saying, that's totally fine, but please just let me know if something comes up and we'll strategize on how to say it.
About palliative physicians, so talking about end of life care and other patients with other languages, sometimes the interpreters themselves are uncomfortable with the topic. So, a Chinese patient, for example, the Chinese interpreter, I understand Chinese, so I can tell that she's uncomfortable. And so, I think it speaks to what you said about training, but while we're working on the training aspect, what can we do in real time when these are uncomfortable topics to really talk about. So
any
advice would be great.
Yeah. So I think it's always, palliative care doc, I'm sure you've been in the situation where you're in a family meeting where you have a bunch of different subspecialists there and you suddenly realize in the middle of the meeting that we're not on the same page. And you're like, oh gosh, this is the worst possible time to learn that we're not on the same page. And so kind of from the beginning, if it's an in-person interpreter in particular, gauging their body language and things. So since I, my hospital is, I would say, medium-sized, so all the interpreters know me. And so they know that they're coming when they're like, ooh, it's Dr. Kinderman. And they round the corner and there's kind of that look on their face. And so, I can kind of get ahead of things. And I know the interpreters feel a little bit more comfortable and a little less comfortable. So I might be a little bit more gentle or, those sorts of things. And ask them and say these are the things that I'm intending to talk about. These are where we've gotten with the patient before. These are the barriers. What concerns do you have about going in? Do you have questions about the terminology? Do you have any concerns about sharing this information or how to do this in a culturally sensitive way? Because then you're communicating respect for them to say, I know that this is there are cultures where it's not just that it's not fun to talk about death and dying. I'd say in America, we're really good at pretending that death doesn't happen. But in other cultures, it's not just that it's taboo, but it's actually like a curse, you're making it happen, or making it happen faster. And so to say, I get that that's a concern, and that might be a concern for our patient as well. And so I'm, one of the things that I want to do is ask who wants to be part of this conversation. So the patient says, I want you to talk to my daughter, I want you to talk to my family, I actually don't want the details. That might alleviate some of the discomfort that the interpreter has, but to say, sometimes we actually assume that the patient doesn't want to know anything, and they actually do. So we can't, this is like what Heather was talking about this morning around cultural humility, cultural competence would be understanding for some cultures where it's uncomfortable to talk about it, but humility would be more to say, I'm not going to assume just because you're Chinese that you don't want to hear about it.
So, piggyback on the same questions.
You talk to the interpreter outside and you ask them, are you comfortable having these conversations? And you go in and you can sort of get that uncomfortable feeling that this person is really not delivering the message adequately by body language. So what do you do at those times?
I bail out, honestly. I've used the language group Tagalog a lot this morning because there's a patient I'm caring for in our hospital right now who's monolingual Tagalog speaking, and we don't have any professional Tagalog interpreters in person. And so our interpreter services tells us to use the staff that's there on the unit, and so we used one of the nurses, and it was like my worst case scenario nightmare. I mean, it was just like I could hear her saying a bunch of English. I would say something, and then the words that she used in English, because she didn't have good proficiency, I was like, I didn't use anything close to that word. What are you talking to this person about? And so I stopped her a couple of times, and I'm like, we're downgrading to just review of systems. Like, I'm not gonna do anything else with you because it would be unethical. I have no idea what she's actually saying. It might really set back the relationship. And then I would get the person's number. Honestly, I would say, I don't want to ever work with that person again.
Do you find that you have opportunities at times in that kind of setting, when they're in person, that you have time to educate them about what palliative care is or discuss their own personal feelings about it so that you have a more educated person and you're more educated about them as well? Are there formal or informal opportunities? I'm thinking a formal program would be wonderful, and just for dialysis, you know, the technology of that always makes me crazy when I use an interpreter, because if they haven't seen pictures, it's just gobbledygook.
Yeah.
It truly is, and I have to cringe in the instances when I've had to do that, especially over the phone, because I just have no idea what their image is in their head of what I'm telling them to interpret.
Yeah. So I would say, you know, for those of you who work with people who have interpreter services on site and you have in-person interpreters that you work with again and again, it goes so far to reach out to them and offer training. I think that one thing that I didn't appreciate until I was in my current role, is that a lot of these interpreters are coming out of cultures where there's this massive power structure between doctors and other people. So it's even like, you know, other healthcare providers. So I think that I need to go out of my way as a doctor to say, your input is really valuable to me, and I want you to feel as comfortable as possible in these difficult conversations. I want you to tell me when you're having, you know, this is really stressful or you don't know. I want the interpreter to not just make something up as we go along when they don't know what I'm saying, but to say, Dr. Kinderman, I don't quite understand. Can you tell me, you know, explain it in a different way or something? And I think, you know, so if you have a smaller group, I mean, taking them through, you know, the equipment and showing them those things and saying, like, these are the ways that I explain it. How would you say that in your language? You know, do you have the words that, you know, you would use? And then if you're thinking specifically about the end-of-life conversations, I would say the interpreting and palliative care curriculum would be a great place to start. So as we're wrapping up, I want to do this. I did this once years ago, and it completely changed the way that I talk with patients. So maybe we can cluster in groups of, like, three or four, and what it is you're interpreting just in English. What your goal is you're gonna have one person, if you get in like a group of three, who asks a question, and then one person pretends they're the patient and they do the answer, and then the third person just tries to repeat the answer that the patient gave as accurately as you can. So quickly get into groups of like three or four.